You know, welcome to the Federal Way City Council, February 7th edition. Would you all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. And thank you for venturing out on a cold, wintry night. We've got some important business to attend to, and some really fun business to attend to very first. We are joined by our friend, my friend, Kelly Maloney, and I'm going to embarrass Kelly a little bit, but we are here to present the key to the city of Federal Way to Kelly Maloney, our former council member colleague, and she's not just our former colleague, she's our friend. And we worked on so many initiatives together, but on some of you who were here may recall this little anecdote, but I want to say it again. I first met Kelly when I was going neighborhood to neighborhood to talk about whether Federal Way should have an elected mayor. And I went to our to a neighborhood. I went to a number of different neighborhoods. I ended up in someone's kitchen table, and a bunch of neighbors came in. And we had a great discussion, and Steve McNay was with me at the time. He had driven all the way across the country to help join this effort. And then one of the neighbors came, and she had this big, you know, those illegal size yellow pads. And she had a bunch of questions that she had written down on this legal pad. And, of course, I looked at that legal pad, and I thought, boy, there's a lot written on there. And about 2.5 hours later, after we'd gone through all of her questions, I thought, that person's got a lot on the ball, and that person probably needs to get involved. In fact, I remember during that conversation, this was back in 2009, God, doesn't that seem like a long time ago now? 8 years ago, because it is, 8 years ago. And I remember saying to Steve, we got in a car and left, I said, that person's going to do something in this city, and I know she's going to do great things. And that's exactly what Kelly did. One of the things that Kelly has talked about passionately, And this is really what one of the main reasons why what prompted me is the groundbreaking memorandum of understanding that we just signed between the University of Washington, Federal Way Public Schools, and Highline College and the City of Federal Way, on a mutual decision to work together to have a branch campus, a higher education facility in the city of Federal Way. And Kelly Maloney relentlessly talked about that during the time before she was on the council, the time that she was on the council. And we talked about this all the time, about her desire, not only for the education benefit of it, but also another passion of Kelly's, which was economic development, which when I became mayor, I asked Kelly, Councilmember Maloney at the time, to work with me and the council on that so very vital issue. So it is with great honor that I have the key to the city for Kelly Maloney, and let me go ahead and read it. And we're going to take pictures, and then we're going to hear from Kelly and maybe from some of the council members. It reads, "The key to the city of Federal Way." You know what? I need my glasses. Hold on. My Costco readers. All right. "Key to the city of Federal Way," presented February 7th, 2017, to Kelly Dahl Maloney by Mayor Jim Farrell. "For your forward-thinking vision, including working to bring a university campus to Federal Way and rebrand the city's image, as well as your continued advocacy of promoting the best of our community." Kelly Maloney, it's my honor. You guys, let's go down. Let's all do the big, this is from all of us. Let's come on down and let's do a big picture. Okay, Stephanie, 3 minutes. Just kidding.
Yeah, I don't, Jim. I need to call you mayor now. I don't have a legal pad, but I do have a little a little speech to. No, I'm just kidding. No, actually, I really appreciate this very much, and I appreciate all the council and the mayor giving me this great honor. And it's really weird being on this side of the podium, but I can appreciate it. So I. Anyway, it's really great. You know, at my last council meeting, I said a lot, and so I'm not going to rehash a lot of that, but I just want to make sure that everyone knows that considering this honor, I just want to add that I'm just so happy to receive the key to the city on behalf of the citizens of Federal Way, because so many of you have come to me over the years, and you've shared your concerns and your hopes and your dreams about the city, and we've worked together on many initiatives, and I really look at this this key as your key. So I appreciate this very much. The other thing I want to say is that I think there are a lot of people out there who probably deserve it more than I do, but I will take it. And with that, I'm just really honored, and I appreciate it very much. So thank you all for this. Thank you for this. Thank you. You did not have to buzz me down.
Well, thank you, Kelly. It's so well deserved. And you guys, we've got cake in the back, and we've got I think we've got some gluten-free cupcakes too. So we got to make sure we had that. So why don't we recess? Let's do a full 15 minutes to make sure that we can really just spend some time with Kelly and our neighbors and kick up our heels a little bit. So thank you, Kelly. We need Deanie. Where's Deanie? I don't want to hit the gavel if I don't know where Deanie's at. Do you see her? There she is. I am really worried about these people in the cold, and I'm not getting the sense of urgency from certain people. And I saw Brian, and I'm like,
I saw the piece of contract. Have you seen the contract?
I have not seen it yet. I know.
It's what, 3 weeks?
I know. I know.
Sorry, I was just getting good news from Tom.
Oh, good, good. Thank you. Okay, now all we need is Bob. Okay, we've got everybody back up here. Once again, congratulations, Kelly. Thank you so much for all you've done for our community. Okay, before we move on to the rest of our agenda, Councilmember Honda, who is co-chairing with Sherry Edwards, our Homeless Women and Children's Initiative, has a special announcement regarding available shelter for tonight. Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. New Hope Community Church is open tonight for emergency shelter, and that's for women and children, men and single men and single women. And they do have a sign-in time, a cutoff around 10 o'clock. So if you know someone who needs shelter, they can go and have shelter, a warm place to sleep, and a safe place to sleep tonight.
All right. Thank you. And before we go any further, I just want to say, you know, instead of waiting until we get to the report and the presentations, this city owes a big debt of gratitude to our public works staff and the relentless snow plowing that they have done over the course of the past 48 hours. Thank you very much. I want to let you know, Marwan and I were on the phone on Saturday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and the original plan was to start plowing at 4 o'clock in the morning. And then I get an update from Marwan that, no, they're going to start plowing on Sunday night at 9:30 p.m. when it was apparent that we were going to be hit with that big snowstorm. And they went all night and into the early morning, and then they had the switch over. So, and they went from five trucks. Actually, I think it was from four trucks to five trucks, and then to six. Did they go to six? Then we, Marwan, go ahead.
We started with five trucks, and then at 7 o'clock in the morning, we got enough resources to have six trucks on the road. So,
yeah, that's great. Thank you very much. And obviously, you know, it's a safety issue. And obviously, the school district for the past 2 days has called off school. But we've got, you know, tens of thousands of people who need to get out and about to get to their work, to get to the store, to get to, you know, friends and loved ones. And so we very much appreciate it. All right, now let's move on to the presentations. We've got Toastmasters Week, February 5th through 12th. Deputy Mayor Burbage.
Thank you very much. I would like to invite Don Everly Smith. I believe he's here. Yes, Don. He's the co-founder of Twin Lakes Toastmasters Club and a professional presenter at Never Speechless in Seattle. And I'm pleased that you're at the podium for presentation of the proclamation for Toastmasters Week. And you have some other individuals there?
I do.
Would you like to introduce them before I read the proclamation?
Yes, there's Area Director Aubrey Lynn from District or Division 41, and that's seven, three clubs of ours in the Federal Way area. And then also Marvin Wiley is the Division 42 Director. And then one of our district officers is Mike Marion. He's also with the Good News Club as well. And he's one of the top three officers in our district. So we're glad to be here today for another one of these open houses for Toastmasters.
Well, thank you for all being here. I will read the proclamation and then present it. Whereas Toastmasters International is a leading organization in making effective oral communication a national and international reality for all persons. Whereas the ability to speak in a clear and effective manner is a powerful and important skill that can help to overcome barriers to effective performance in virtually every endeavor and line of work. And whereas, by helping develop essential communication skills, Toastmasters International performs a valuable service. And whereas, after more than 8 decades of outstanding achievement, Toastmasters International has grown to over 12,500 clubs in 113 countries worldwide, with nearly 5,000 members in the state of Washington. And now, therefore, we, the undersigned mayor and city council of the city of Federal Way, do hereby proclaim February 5th through the 12th as Toastmasters International Week in the city of Federal Way, and encourage the people of our city to recognize the accomplishments and opportunities in communication and public speaking, which this outstanding organization has realized for people everywhere.
Thank you very much. Don wanted to know if we could say a few words. I'm sure that the mayor and those who know Don would think that's a very funny comment. First of all, Mr. Mayor and the City Council, we'd like to thank you very much for having us here this evening. I have been an active Toastmaster for 10 years, and I would like to share with all of you that it is not only a club about public speaking, but it's about leadership, it's about communication, it's about listening skills. And when you take all of that and put it together, it is an advancement in your personal relationships within your family, with your friends, with the places that you work, and working in the community, as all of you are doing here. I encourage you, if you're terrified of speaking, it is a place to begin. I have friends that have been in Toastmasters for a whole year before they actually opened their mouth, and yet today they are distinguished Toastmasters, the highest award that you can have in this organization. It is my pleasure to be here and to tell you that I'm the area director, and there are 4 clubs in your area that I'm responsible for: Twin Lakes Toastmasters, Federal Way Toastmasters, Wake Up for Wealth Toastmasters, and Clearly the Best. And each one of them has a different culture and has a different time frame. Some are early in the morning, some are at lunchtime, some are in the evening. So there is a place for each one of you to be able to find a suitable time to go to. I would ask you to investigate all clubs and find one that fits for you. So it is my pleasure to be here tonight. I thank all of you for having us, and I would like to turn the microphone over to my coworker, Marvin Wiley. Marvin?
Good evening, and it is a pleasure that the City of Federal Way has decided to declare this week as Toastmasters Week. And my name is Marvin, and I'm serving as the Area 42 Director for the Federal Way area. The clubs I serve are the Good News Toastmaster, which Mike standing behind me here is a member of, as well as Vocal Dialysis and Northwest Church Toastmasters as well. And they're all located locally in Federal Way, and everyone is welcome to come and visit. And Toastmasters, it's a great organization as far as, like, the main reason why I joined about 3 years ago, and the biggest reason why I wanted to join was I had a very bad stutter, and that was pretty frustrating, not being able to speak and communicate. And communication is very important as far as once you're looking to advance in the world, and Toastmasters serves as that great platform so that you can build your confidence and be able to advance and do things that you didn't know that you could do in the future. And so I would encourage you all, if you're interested in improving in the area of communication leadership, then you can check out one of the clubs in Federal Way and go from there. And thank you, Mr. Mayor, for declaring this as Toastmasters Week. And I'd like to introduce Don here to talk about an upcoming open house that's coming soon. Thanks.
Thank you. To the showcase for our Toastmasters Week, the pinnacle event will be tomorrow night
and that will be Wednesday night at 6:30 at Brookdale Foundation House. And it's a joint citywide celebration of Toastmasters Weeks with representatives from all seven clubs coming together. Again, the idea is find the club that's best for you. Just so you can do that, there is a sheet of paper left at the counter over here. So if you want to find out when we meet, where they meet, here's a good reference point and a contact information as well. Our event tomorrow night, the keynote is going to be called Step In, Step Up, and Step Out, the Toastmasters Paths to Significance. That will be delivered by Cindy Sledvogt, who's an officer at First American Title, and also the president of the Wake Up for Wealth Toastmasters that meets 7 o'clock Friday morning, where success comes early. Thank you for having us, and hope to see you tomorrow night. And there's some flyers for both events and a business card at the counter. Thank you.
All right.
Deputy
thank
Mayor,
you.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. All right. Okay, now we've got a proclamation, Black History Month. Councilmember Lydia Sepha-Dawson.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to invite Dion Shell, Director of Operations at GredTex and a volunteer program director at Good Shepherd Youth Outreach, to come to the podium for the proclamation. Whereas much of Federal Way's honor, strength, and distinction can be attributed to the diversity of cultures and traditions that are celebrated by the residents of this great region, and whereas African Americans have played a significant role in the history of our nation and Washington State's economic, cultural, spiritual, and political development while working tirelessly to promote their culture and history, and whereas, as a result of their determination, hard work, and perseverance, African Americans have made valuable and lasting contributions to our community and our state, achieving exceptional success in all aspects of society, including business, education, politics, science, and the arts. And whereas all African Americans are encouraged to reflect on past successes and challenges of African Americans and look to the future to improve society so that we live up to the ideals of freedom, equality, and justice. And whereas Black History Month encourages unity and promotes the American ideal of equal education, social, and economic opportunities for all citizens. And whereas the City of Federal Way believes in the equality of all people and recognizes the value added to our community by our diversity. And now, therefore, we understand Mayor and City Council of the City of Federal Way do hereby proclaim February 2017 as Black History Month in the City of Federal Way and encourage the people of our city to join together in making this a period of rededication to the principles of justice and equality for all. Signed this 7th day of February 2017. If you'd like to say something, Molly.
Thank you, Mayor Farrell, and the members of City Council. Really appreciate it. During a time when our country is really in transition, it's very hopeful, and it's a great period when you guys can acknowledge something like that. Black History Month is something that's really important to a lot of descendants of people who made a lot of sacrifices for this country to be what it is. So we really appreciate it, and look out, there's going to be more to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Dion. Before you leave the Dion, before you leave that general area, I just want to point out to everybody, we all remember those 3 days in May of last year, which really shook not just this city but the region, about the incredible violence that occurred. And you recall, if you will, just a few short weeks after that, we had a huge community meeting at which we were like 5 or 6 deep in these very chambers, absolutely packed to the gills. And at first, when we were sitting up here, this is about the addressing the violent crime that occurred in our community. Dion was one of the people. I remember exactly where he sat. I remember the hat he was wearing. Because what Dion said with the first half hour of that meeting This community was scared. We were upset. The regional media was taking a look at our community and asking, why did this happen? And Dion got up during his opportunity to speak. And I really felt like after he got up and talked, you could, and I don't know, you know, I know that I'm talking to my colleagues, the entire mood of this chamber changed because we realized that that division was not going to help us move forward, coming together as a community. And that's one of the reasons why I asked Dion to be a member after the council suggested that we have a violence prevention coalition. And then I appointed the members of the commission. I saw Dion's name in that list, and I said, this young man needs to be on that committee and on that commission. So on behalf of a grateful community, thank you, Dion. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, certificates of appointment. Deputy Mayor Burbage, in regard to Lodging Tax Advisory Committee.
Thank you. I would like to request that we postpone presenting these certificates. None of the three, it turns out, could be here this evening. So if we could instead schedule them for a subsequent meeting, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now Councilmember Copeng for Youth Commission.
I'm pleased to invite Olivia Chung and Gaurav Gowda to come forward to receive their certificates of appointment to the Youth Commission. If you could meet me at the podium.
Hi, I'm Olivia Chong. I just want to thank the council and mayor for appointing me a Youth Commission representative. I'm very happy and very excited for this opportunity, so thank you.
I just wanted to thank the council for appointing me in the Youth Commission, and I'm ready to start helping the youth of federal way. So thank you to the mayor and the council. All
right. Okay, and then Councilmember Copeng also has a diversity commission appointments.
I'd like to invite Timothy Detweiler to come forward to receive her certificate of appointment to the diversity commission. And her appointment says, Timothy Detweiler is hereby appointed to serve as an alternative member. It's easy for me to read, not so hard or easy to say. Is hereby appointed to serve as an alternate member of the Federal Diversity Commission for a term to expire May 31st, 2019. Timothy?
I won't keep you too long. I find myself up here really wishing I'd attended a few meetings of Toastmasters. But Mr. Mayor, City Council, thank you for the appointment, and I look forward to getting started.
Okay, Northlake Management District, Councilmember Selsky.
Yes, thanks, Mayor Farrell. Yes, I'm honored to ask Lois Kucha and Lawrence Zimniski to please come to the podium. And maintenance and management of our surface water resources in the city is very critical, and I'm just glad you both, along with the other commissioners, could volunteer your time to do this very important job for our city, so thank you.
Well, thanks to the city for having a Northlake Management District, and thank you for appointing the two of us. We look forward to working on the committee. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank the mayor and the council, too, for recognizing the gem. These lakes, North Lake, Lake Charlotte, are irreplaceable in this community. And I'm glad that we all are on the same channel. Thank you.
Thank you, Lawrence. Okay. Now in regard to Mayor's emerging issues and report, I had my State of the City address last Wednesday at the Twin Lakes Golf and Country Club. It was great. We had, I think about 170, 175 folks there. It was good. It was an opportunity for me to talk about what we're doing. I do want to point out that you've probably seen rotating pictures. This is what the Performing Arts and Events Center looks like right now. It's dark out, so maybe not right this minute. But this is the current state of affairs with the PAC. It looks absolutely beautiful. We have raised $21.5 million toward this, and we're well on our way to, and I'll talk about the next step in regard to financing here in just a few minutes. So that's great. I talked about the new Town Square Park and how beautiful that looks, and a real gem in our community. We're working on in negotiations for the hotel that will go next to this facility. We're just talking about all kinds of things. As I mentioned earlier, I talked about Sherry Edwards and Councilmember Honda with the new initiative to make sure that we address gaps in services and redundancy in services to make sure, one only need to go outside for just a few minutes and realize just how deathly cold it is out there. And we need to make sure that folks that don't have a place to go have somewhere to go, especially mothers with children. And that's why in talking with Susan and Sherry, it was the Homeless Mothers and Children Initiative to make sure that families, don't have to split up and that there's resources. And we also were finding, as we were putting information online, it was very difficult to, number one, get accurate, up-to-date information on a day-to-day basis, and that the individual shelters would be open. And so we're working right now with New Hope Church, as is mentioned, to make sure that they're open on an emergent basis, and then they're going to be taking a look at long-term issues. So I just talked about the economic development issue, that's issues that are happening in the city of Federal Way, a lot of great businesses coming to Federal Way, and just all kinds of great developments. I'm honored to be your mayor. We had our budget presentation, our budget process last year. We've got good things going on in the city, and it's an honor to be your mayor. So I'm not going to give you the state of the city right now. I think I can probably put the PowerPoint on the city Facebook, not Facebook, on the city website for your review. But needless to say, I think it was a great time to talk not just about where we've been, but where we're going. And so we've got a great city council, all kinds of great things are happening. Okay, we had our annual city council retreat last Saturday. We had quite a number of the members of the public there. Deputy Mayor, any thoughts on how the council retreat went?
Thank you. I was pleased. There was good interaction, discussion by the council, and certainly participation by the community members who were there as well. It's always a treat to be able to hear directly from folks who express their concerns and ideas, suggestions for us. But we covered quite a long list of topics, managed to postpone only one of them, and had an opportunity to hear from each council member on the various topics and to share ideas and put forth some goals, some direction for the future. But I would like to give other council members an opportunity to comment as well.
Councilmember Duclos, do you want to talk about the subcommittee that we ask Councilmember Moore to chair? All right, Councilmember Moore.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor, and thank you to my colleagues. A sincere thank you to my colleagues. I'm really excited to be introducing a new ad hoc subcommittee for the council that will report into the FEDRAC committee, so I look forward to working with my colleagues. It's going to be called the Transparency and Communications Ad Hoc Committee. And I know that we can always do a better job to improve transparency, to make information accessible, and to empower citizens with their government. So that's what my goals are. Look forward to laying out a foundation for this. Look forward to discussing and seeking memberships for this ad hoc committee. I do expect to involve the community, a variety of diverse crowd, and I'm just looking forward to the results, and more importantly, I'm looking forward to a year from today, the council discussing the recommendations that this ad hoc committee will come up with, and hopefully fully getting behind it and supporting those recommendations. Thank you so much to the councils again. I really appreciate this. I think it's a really important work. And with that, I'll pass it back to you, Mayor.
And I think some of the Councilmember Selsky.
Oh, sure. I'll just chime in a little bit. We spent, I think, about 6 or 7 hours at the meeting, and we covered, as the deputy mayor said, a whole host of issues, many of which are some of the important things that we're addressing in the city right now. And I think we really had lively discussion, respectful discussion. I think we came up with some ideas on how to move forward, but what I really appreciate are the citizens who were there. We had a lot of folks, many of whom are here this evening, there who were providing feedback either formally or informally during the meeting. And so it was just a good exchange of ideas. We again had some measurable results and some things we can really get moving forward as we as we go forward in the city. So thank you all for those that were there, and thank you all for everybody who is here tonight participating in this open meeting. So thank you.
Very good. Okay. Councilmember Duclos.
Well, I'm going to take a little bit of a different tactic here, because I expressed this at the meeting. We did cover a lot of topics, some of which we'd already covered here in City Council. My thought of a retreat, however, is more looking towards the future and having discussions about what we want to see for the future, what we want our city to look like, what we want our citizens to be involved in, and how we can meet the needs of our community as it grows. And so I was somewhat disappointed in that we didn't spend time talking about that. We spent time talking more on, I thought, things that we could handle here at City Council or in subcommittee. So in the future, if we have another retreat like that, and I think more citizens would come to a retreat that's open and forward-looking so that we could get input from them, too, in an informal and relaxed atmosphere at Dumas Bay, which is a beautiful place to be. And the weather was very cooperative, and it wasn't cold. But that's what I would like to see for our next retreat. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Okay, Council, anyone else? All right, thank you very much. All right, so actually I would go back just for a moment and say that the State of the City and the City Council retreat will both be televised on Channel 21. The retreat, because it was 7 hours, will be obviously condensed down into a watchable, probably more like a 45-minute highlights. But the State of the City will obviously be on Channel 21 as well. So look for those in upcoming programs. New market tax credit updates. We are working hard on, along with our economic development director, Tim Johnson, on closing in on our new markets. We've got a strategy. We've got a consultant that we're working on. So news should be forthcoming here pretty quickly. We're ready to go, and there's been a lot of work done. So just wanted to say thank you to Tim for all your work. We don't quite have a deal in place yet, but we're working on getting that done. Also at the State of the City, I did announce the creation of the Safe and Quiet Skies Citizen Task Force. I've asked Colonel Robert Blix, retired Army, to head that up. And he's an individual that is, I think, was an Alaska Airlines pilot for several decades, and with some military experience as well. And we're getting at least, I believe, 10 to 11 members of the community that are well-versed. We had a community meeting here that filled this chamber back in 2015, and we're following up we'll be working with the airport and also with our neighbors just to make sure that any growth at the airport in regard to their expansion keeps in mind that there are people who live under these planes, and our quality of life stands to be affected by this increased traffic. And so that's what that's going to be working on. So we'll keep you informed of that and about a meeting schedule when it's adopted. Okay, with that, that is the conclusion of my report. I'll go ahead and we've got the most important part of the evening, which is citizen comment. Okay, so I'll go ahead and, as is my practice, to list off the couple names, and then we'll go from there. So Ernest Comedone, and then Jamie Hanen, and then Tim Cook.
Hello.
is it Commodore?
Commodore.
Sorry, sir.
Yes, I'm Ernest Commodore, and I'm here to talk about the property tax.
Yes, sir.
And I've listened to some of the comments, and you said that you're trying to help people and everything, and that's good. But we need to start, but first things first, because if you're trying to take down the mountain by taking off the top first, it don't work. So what I'm saying is that if you can get the property tax lowered, maybe we can help those mothers that you're talking about to have kids that need a place to stay, because the guy who owns the house, excuse me, or the apartment, he's not going to come down on his rent if his property tax is way up here. The city is coming to get theirs, and the person who's coming to rent, they want cheaper rent. So he's in the middle. He's going to absorb all that. He's not going to do that. He can't afford to do that. So if you give the property owner a break, maybe they can give the renter a break on the rent, because we're trying to lower the rent, but the property tax is coming up underneath you, and that's not going to work. So if we could work on a plan or a program or something while you're trying to help the mothers and all the homeless people, because if it wasn't too long ago, Federal Way didn't have people sleeping in the churches tonight and tomorrow and, you know, looking for places from night to night. We didn't have that here. That was in Seattle and some other places. But now it's at Reach Home here in Federal Way. So to help the homeowners in Federal Way as well as other property owners, we need to try to lower the property tax, because Seattle's overrun. We saw what happened in Seattle. Saw the other day they're kicking old people out of the 91-year-old guy, kicking them out of an old folks home because the rent is so good. So he get $15 to $2,000 a month rent from renting versus somebody in an old folks home is getting maybe $700 or $800. So it has turned into that right now at this time. And you don't want Federal Way to be that way, because you got homeless people living right amongst us, you know. And you see what happened with the homeless people. They need a place to stay, so they're sleeping in the woods right behind your house. And then after a while, they start taking stuff from your house. So to keep things down, we have a jump. We see what happened in other major cities, and Federal Way has a chance to do better. Federal Way is a good place. It's a beautiful place, and I like it. And it's not far from Seattle, and we got the best of two worlds. We're not in Seattle, you're not in Tacoma. And, you know, so if we can do something about it, then, you know, it'll be a lot better, because just recently they had like 50-something or 100-some houses just built right in Twin Lakes right up here, and they're getting all the property tax from that. So with that, the city shouldn't be starving. I know my time is up, but the city shouldn't be starving, so we should try to do something about that. I'd like a response from the mayor, if possible.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Commodore. You know, in regard to our property taxes, I hear what you're saying in regard to, you know, taxation in general. In fact, actually, we've got an agenda item later in our agenda. When they locked in property taxes at the current rate, subject to an initiative back in, I believe, 20 years ago, 1996 now, they locked us in at a lower rate than almost all of our neighbors. In fact, the city of Auburn takes in $6 million a year, more than the city of Federal Way does, on property taxes, simply because they were at a higher rate than we were right now. And so, certainly we'll look at it, but because of that initiative, we're actually locked in to no more than 1% a year. So that, but anyway, that's a bigger issue, Mr. Commodore. I'd love to talk to you about it more in detail. Finance is obviously a multiple complicated issue, but we could talk about it later. Please feel free to reach out to my office, and maybe we could sit down and have a cup of coffee in my office. Okay, thank you, sir. Okay, and then we had Jamie Hanen, and then Tim Cook.
Yeah, I'm here to expose illegal police surveillance and illegal police tactic called gang stalking. It's a very serious issue. I caught the device Stinger being used unconstitutionally on my parents. And 4 years ago, the Tacoma police were sued for a class action lawsuit for using the device out in public. Well, four individuals were also gang stalked, which is the same issue I'm having. The NAACP and LaRon Baker, the attorney for the ACLU, filed this class action lawsuit. It was appealed to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court stated, nobody owns radio waves, law enforcement doesn't need warrants to track suspects. Well, the Tacoma police use it in public. Not everybody in public is a suspect. 110 suspects had their cases thrown out due to this issue. In 2015, Jay Inslee signed into law, cell site simulator law, preventing this issue from happening again. Well, I caught the law enforcement using this device illegally, breaking the similar law that was passed in 2015, using a bug detector on my cell phone. While driving home, I turned the power off my cell phone, so there was no relay to the satellite. I turned the power on, placed it on my phone, it never blinked, so there's no beam laser being sent to my cell phone until I reached the driveway. The driveway, the bug detector would not stop blinking because it was catching the radio waves. This device was it mimics a cell phone tower, so it was catching radio waves. A perimeter was set up around my parents' house, catching radio waves. Okay, well, my parents aren't suspects, so they just had their constitutional rights violated, which leads to the breaking the 2015 cell site similar law, and now I'm being gang stalked because this illegal surveillance is being used by police to spy on victims to see who they associate with, and they use it to block the radio waves so employment can't contact me, so I can't get a job, and they use informants sabotaging cars so I now don't have transportation, and then using informants with threats, which is documented on dispatch four times, December 20th, December 21st, December 27th, and January 2nd. I'm isolated on social media, prevent me from contacting anybody because law enforcement doesn't want me revealing what I discovered, so I'm the target because I'm a threat to the law enforcement. So gang stalking is used to eliminate the threat, driving its victims crazy by using informants to mentally mess with them, stealing from, robbing my parents' house, and then stealing every resource they can. Well, it drives people homeless because if I didn't have a mother, I would have no transportation, not a place to live. I would be sleeping on the side of the road right now. So this is a very serious issue, and I take it very personal. And I've contacted Governor Jay Inslee's constituents about this matter, requesting a meeting and to start an investigation on the police. And when the investigation confirms my accusations are 100% correct, I got witnesses, reports, everything to back up all my accusations, and there's probably going to be a class action lawsuit pursuing law enforcement for breaking my constitutional rights and my parents. So I wish I could tell you more. I got evidence and everything to back up my accusations, but I wish I had more time. Thank you.
Thank you. Tim Cook. And then Robin Cook.
Mayor, Deputy Mayor, Council Members. I'm a citizen of Federal Way, and I'm a 21-year resident of the North Lake community. As you well know, starting in late last August, individuals have been speaking up about the proposed plans to develop a portion of the newly owned IRG property. And then every couple of weeks at the council meetings since then, there's been ongoing public comment on the plans for developing the property. So I ask, who owns the property? Is it the City of Federal Way? Is it a public trust? Or another government entity? No, it's IRG, a privately held real estate development firm. All privately held property comes with rights. Where do the rights of the property owner, in this case IRG, get to be acknowledged and respected? If we applied the same logic to a residential lot, several houses in our neighborhood that have been built recently would not be standing today. They are there because of the property owner's right to build on them, even if several people in the neighborhood are not in favor of the design of the houses. I am speaking tonight on the behalf of the private property owners' right to develop. We have rights too. So I urge you to expedite the pending permits and development rights of the IRG property. Thank you.
All right, thank you, sir. All right, Robin Cook. And then Gary Grant.
Good evening, Mayor, council members, community, friends, neighbors, etc. I'm here today to tell you a little story that I learned when I was in charge of an organization, and we had an annual event, and at the end of the event I went back to the organization and I said, tell me what went well and what didn't go well. Well, this went over several weeks of conversation, and the same 5 to 6 people spoke up every single time telling me what I needed to do to make it better. And I thought, well, you know what, I haven't heard from the other people in the group. So I developed a survey, sent it out, and I was surprised. In fact, I was actually shocked. The 5 to 6 people that spoke up were the only 5 to 6 people that thought that way. Everyone else thought something differently. So I know a couple weeks ago I said that the loudest voice is not the only voice. I decided to share that story to just show that point, that there are others in the North Lake area and surrounding that have another viewpoint and have not shared that with all of you, and you continue to hear the ones with the loudest voice. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Gary Grant. Oh, there you are. And then after Gary, then Lori Sechrist, and then Tashauna Nash, and Richard Pearson. Mr. Grant.
Good evening. Came here to talk about a dangerous intersection, and that intersection is Southwest 21st and Southwest 349th Place. I've spoken about this many times to this council, to the mayor, and this problem has been going on for over 10 years. It's been an issue. I was told by the mayor that he would have the people that I've been talking to here and get with me, and I was given this piece of crap, which is the same thing that has happened every time a citizen has an issue with something that's going on with one of the departments. They put in things like claim. They don't get facts and tell you facts. Here's the fact. At that intersection, the church was put in. Their driveway is offset from the corner. Originally, they were turning left because that's the only way they could get in from 21st going south. Every time they have their meetings, anyone turning left onto Southwest 349th Place puts themselves in jeopardy because, one, the offset driveway to the corner puts their vehicle halfway into your vehicle. And if anybody knows the law, if I turn left in front of you and you decide to go straight, I'm at fault. So when I get information back from the city that says we don't have enough money to correct this problem, we haven't had enough accidents at that intersection to warrant spending money on it. And I tell you, none of you in this room is going to purposely wreck your vehicle to prove a point. This situation, again, has been over 10 years. There have been things that were done to alleviate this because the church expanded. A light was put in on Southwest 348th with the left-hand turn going south to try to alleviate this. Signs were put up with no left turns into those driveway, in and out. Now, this little piece of paper says I talked to the police. Yes, I did. But this thing says they were reluctant to do anything. That is not the way the conversation went. You need people, one, to recognize situations before it happens, because people are telling you before you let them have permits to do these things that there are issues. And stop telling us that we'll wait and see what happens. We will revisit it, because that is what has happened on just about everything else. And when we do come up and say, here, we've got proof, we're going to show you, then it becomes an issue of we don't have money to do it. And then this is trying to pit people against the other organizations, which is totally crap. And I advise Andy Wong, as I have in the past, get facts first.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Grant. When public comment is over, I'll ask Marwan Saloom, our public works director, to give an update on that, as Rick Perez, our senior traffic engineer, could not be here tonight. Lori Sechrist is up next, and then Tashauna Nash.
Lori Sechrist.
So thank you, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, City Council, City Staff, and community for listening to me again tonight. And also thank you to Lois and Larry for stepping up to the plate and being appointed to the North Lake Management District. So last month I spoke on a few, I have 5 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So last month I spoke on a few of the goals and policies from the Federal Way Comprehensive Plan regarding the city's environmental stewardship and water resources. So tonight I'd like to build on this discussion as it relates to tree preservation and open spaces. So starting in section 9.5 as it relates to tree preservation. This states that the city benefits in maintaining its urban tree canopy by stabilizing and enriching soils, improving air and water quality, protecting fish and wildlife habitat, reducing the impacts of stormwater runoff, mitigating the heat island effects, and enhancing the economic value of new and existing development. The goal is to preserve and enhance the city's physical and aesthetic character by incentivizing the preservation of mature trees and preventing untimely and indiscriminate removal or destruction of trees. And a few of the policies from this section are to provide greater tree density credits for retained mature trees, encourage minimal modifications of trees within environmental critical areas and their buffers, and encourage preserving forested areas within the tracts and native growth protection easements when subdividing land. So on to section 9.8, as it relates to open space. It states that trails and open space corridors form linkages between and within neighborhoods, commercial areas, and neighboring jurisdictions. Open space corridors also provide wildlife habitat, recreational areas, as well as visual and physical separation between land uses. Open space can include environmental sensitive areas, forests, pasture land, lakes, and waterways. Policy 106 in this section states to preserve and restore habitat connections and tree canopy to link stream corridors, geologically hazardous areas, floodplains, wetlands, and critical habitat sites into a system of habitat corridors. This provides connections for wildlife, supports biodiversity, improves water quality, reduces risks due to flooding and landslides, and supports the city's adaptation to climate change. Other policies state that the city should develop a procedure to acquire or accept donations of high-value areas for preservation. And the city should consider innovative ways of acquiring property for open spaces, such as transfer of development rights and development incentives for set-asides. In reading over these sections, I quickly realized how in line the city's goals are with the goals of the Save Weyerhaeuser campus, which are to protect the west shoreline of the North Lake, the rhododendron garden, and the bonsai collections. By preserving the wildlife and critical watershed land, the forests and meadows of the campus, as well as its trails and public access to them. And preserving and maintaining the character of the campus through high quality development that blends with the environment and brings living wage jobs to the community. So I'm confident that the city's commitment of the $1 million in the King County's Conservation Futures matching support will get the much needed attention from the neighboring cities, state, and federal agencies, as well as public and private entities. But as you know, this is just the first step to reaching our goal. I implore the city to make a giant leap and to make a final decision and make it quickly to partner with either the Trust for Public Lands or Forterra. And I ask that the city provide the necessary resources to make this an informed and unbiased decision, a decision that will be in the best interest of the city, of IRG, and the community. A decision of this magnitude will have lasting impact to protecting this legacy for many generations. Someone once said that they believed we have more in common than not, and the opportunity is now. So please do the right thing and help us protect this land, the habitat, its unique natural features, and preserve its open space and maintain its character. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori. We are literally in the process of and working with you to figure out which one, if either Forterra or TPL, is the better partner. But talks will be ongoing. It's an important decision, and it's a different kind of use depending on which one we go in. But more talks to follow. Ms. Nash.
Good evening. My name is Tashauna Nash. My husband and I are 14-year residents of Federal Way, and I am serving on the Save Weyerhaeuser Campus Board as the chair of fundraising. Tonight, I'm speaking to you as the mother of the three young daughters we are raising in the North Lake neighborhood, the community adjacent to IRG's proposed warehouses, the neighborhood where our kids walk to the bus stop Monday through Friday. A letter that was posted on our Save Weyerhaeuser Campus Facebook page this week has served as another wake-up call for what is personally at stake if the permits are approved for building warehouses on the former Weyerhaeuser campus. The letter was written by Jeff Recor, a 56-year resident of Federal Way who owns a truck dealership selling Class A semi-trucks and trailers. He cites that the number of freight doors at the proposed facilities would bring in 200 to 400 tractor trailers in and out of the site daily. He notes that the trucks that have early morning deliveries generally arrive the evening before, and every retail parking lot, access road, and local road shoulders become the parking choice of those drivers. We live on one of those local roads, and our daughters walk to and wait for the bus on that local road. Another neighbor who works for a trucking company in Kent confirms that parking overnight in residential areas is common, and there are a host of activities the trucks attract, including hard drugs and prostitution. Will one of my daughters be walking among parked semi-trucks on her way to the bus stop in the dark at 6:35 every morning? This is not the vision we have for our children's childhood. It is not the vision for the North Lake neighborhood, and it is not the vision for Federal Way. Please deny the permit for IRG, and let's work together to attract a top company to the campus, one who shares our values and respects our community. Thank you.
Richard Pearson, and then Julie Cleary.
Mayor Farrell, Deputy Mayor Burbage, City Council, other City Council, staff, ladies and gentlemen. It is with appreciation that I address you this evening relative to the Land Use and Transportation's Council Subcommittee passage of a motion giving authorization to apply for the fiscal year 2018 King County Conservation Futures Grant. Our Conservation Committee of the Save Weyerhaeuser Campus Group has met with most of you to elaborate upon the environmental and open space attributes of the property on the west side of North Lake, the headwaters of the East Hylobos drainage. We appreciate the time you have spent with us and your demanding schedules and an openness of your communications. We also acknowledge the commitment of the mayor in this effort and his assignment of senior policy advisor Yarden Weidenfeld to lead this effort. Yarden's level of energy and support are recognized in little over a month since the mayor announced his appointment. The actions of the Land Use and Transportation Committee are the beginning of a once-in-a-generation first step in the preservation of this legacy property for perpetuity. It will be for the full council to act upon this initiative at the next council meeting on February 21st. If you have any questions or suggestions, please let us know. We remain committed to this project and others on the former Weyerhaeuser headquarters site and remain available for your consultation. Sincerely, Richard Pearson.
Thank you, Richard. And then Ms. Cleary has 5 minutes.
Hello, everybody. Let's see. Revising my speech after listening to the last ones that we just had. That was not your dick. Okay,
before that.
Oh, look at that. Okay. So, so we got a great letter this week, and Tashana touched on it a little bit, and I was going to read it, that I received 9 days ago. And it's a person in the community. He says, greetings. Please continue to fight against the warehouse project proposed for Weyerhaeuser. I'm a 56-year resident, and so I won't repeat what she's already said about that. But he goes on to say there's multiple reasons for rejecting the proposed warehouses from the transportation viewpoint. The number of the freight doors at the proposed facilities, and I believe he is referring to when it was the one at each end and not necessarily about the other big one in the middle. 200 to 400 tractor trailers in and out of the sites daily. The only current access is either Highway 18 Weyerhaeuser Way or 320th Street and Weyerhaeuser Way. Both those roadways are congested at least 30% of every weekday currently. It would require some very expensive traffic mitigation to allow the flow of trucks to and from that site. Without traffic mitigation, the congestion will be unbearable for people who live and work in Federal Way. He says trucks that have early morning deliveries, which I won't repeat because she's already kind of told you about that. But what got me was he said some truck drivers do respect the local communities and they don't litter. But others are worse and actually would relieve themselves next to their trucks. But most don't have much respect for the locals while they wait for their appointments. The industrial appearance of the proposed structures is not compatible with the general area. He writes, examine Fife if you need to observe firsthand what placing warehouses too close to the center of a community looks like. It's terrible, period. The traffic during the day is unbearable with the trucks everywhere. Federal Way deserves better. Please don't allow people to be misled into believing this or these projects are good for Federal Way. The few low-paying jobs they may create are small consolations for the non-reversible damage it will do. Projects of the category these structures fall into belong in industrial areas, not in the middle of a pristine park-like setting like Weyerhaeuser campus. We will all regret the approval of these proposed buildings. Keep up the good fight. Regards, Jeff Recor. We went back and forth, and I won't read you all the rest of the other stuff. So last week, because we had the discussion about the TBD, so I actually looked at your six-year transportation package and all the list of projects, and there was one on here that I couldn't quite find enough information on. Actually, it's just listed, so I was wondering if we could find out more about project number 14-01, which is Weyerhaeuser Way South, South 336th Street to 33rd Place South, and widening that to 5 lanes. And there wasn't any backup material or anything on the site. So I'd never known that that was on there. So 14 would mean 2014, it got on there. 01 means first one of the year, I think. So I that'd be kind of cool to get how that got on there and what that was all about. So lastly, I'm just like kind of shocked. You guys know I've done public records requests, but I'm not the only one. Lots of people have done a lot of public records requests, and you guys have them on the FTP site, and that's great. I've gone out there and collected them. I think I've looked at over 2,000 to 3,000 pieces of email, and people have wrote multiple times, so I can't say it's 2,000 to 3,000 different people, right? But I can tell you, I found one letter in semi-support. Let them do whatever they want. And I didn't find any letters from Tim or Robin Cook. I might have missed them. They live in our neighborhood. But one out of thousands. I'm continually shocked. I'm always telling my husband that. The new houses in our neighborhood, they're beautiful. I love them. They're great. One replaced an old rundown mobile home that was time for it to go. So I don't know where that one was coming from. And I think somebody building a home on, is that 5 minutes? Really? Okay, I'm sorry. But it's not the same building a home on your property. You're not affecting the whole city with what building It's just ridiculous. Thank you.
Okay, last two pink sheets are Tom Messmer and Suzanne Vargo. And Marwan, well, Tom is making his way, Mr. Messmer is making his way up here. Do you have any information about that road widening?
We would be more than happy to provide that information to Ms. Clary. So
okay.
I don't have it with me at the present time, but I'll be more than happy to provide it to her.
So what we're going to do is we're going to provide it to, just one moment, Tom, just a second. So what we're going to do is we're going to get you that information, but at the very next council meeting, during maybe my mayor's report, let's talk about that a little bit. You know, what exactly it is, when did it get on there, just the ABCs of it, okay?
We'll do that, Mayor.
Thank you very much, Marwan. And thank you, Julie, for bringing that up. Mr. Messmer, or Tom.
Thank you. Mr. Commodore left. I wanted to thank Mr. Commodore for bringing up the property tax piece. As the guy who just approved $1.8 million in payment of property taxes, I don't know whether there's a larger property tax check that gets written in Federal Way than the one we write. I also wanted to tell him that the other way to handle property taxes is not necessarily to find a way to lower them, but to recall that the Preferred Freezer Project was set to add $850,000 in property tax. Roughly, I mean, you guys know what percentage of it comes to the city, but $400,000 of that was going to go to the schools. We don't have that anymore. I want to thank the cooks. I mean, I know that there's this, you know, I don't want to start a debate over whether there's support or there isn't support. I can't tell you the number of times I've walked out of this meeting where someone would say, I totally get what you guys are doing. I say, why don't you stand up and say that? And the individual will say, my spouse is in the room. So, or the two guys who sat down with me at Poverty Bay and said, we totally get what you, and I thought I was about to get assaulted because it was a day after one of these. And they sat down and brought their coffee and their breakfast and said, we totally get what you're doing. And I said, why don't you come there? And I'm not going to stand up in front of my neighbors and say that. They feel like they're in the minority. Couple of things. So things I always try to, you know, things not to worry about. Traffic. I don't know the number of trucks, and I don't know the number of truck bays, and I don't know how truck bays turn into truck traffic. And the traffic engineers will figure that out, and Rick Perez will work with whoever the traffic engineers are, and you guys will get the right numbers. The current traffic design continues to have everything at the, what I call it, the preferred freezer end, only coming and going from 18, so not traversing Weyerhaeuser Way. The current design at the other end of the campus, at the north end of the current tech center, has trucks coming and going only to 5. So if you follow that line of logic, there are no trucks allowed between those two on Weyerhaeuser Way. Which means that there would be no trucks that could turn into the North Lake neighborhood, but they could never get back out because it could never turn into any of the buildings that they service. So it'd be crazy to go down there. I'm not saying somebody's not crazy, but I'm just saying that the current design is to keep all truck traffic off Weyerhaeuser Way, except for those two little bookends, and all truck traffic out of the traffic circle. So we've heard the comments and taken them to heart. In terms of hearing the comments, the preferred freezer, again, site continues to move forward with a significantly smaller building, more in the neighborhood of about 225,000 square feet, not 310, 36 feet tall, not 66 feet tall. And the architecture is significantly better, and there are trees surrounding the entire building, not just on the required tree buffer, but also on the private road. And I can tell you that the office piece of it in the corner looks more like an REI store than a warehouse. So we continue to try to find, as Laurie Seacrest said, common ground. Thank you. Right.
Thank you, Tom. Okay, Suzanne Vargo.
Hi, everybody. Good evening, Council and fine residents of Frederick Way. Water. You know, I'm always talking about it in one respect, aspect or another. And again, I want to talk to you about the East Hylabos Waterway. I've talked about the wonderful report of the Hylabos Watershed Plan that came out in March of 2016. That was a comprehensive plan to identify problems and execute their solutions. Recently, I discovered an executive proposal basin plan from July of 1991, as well as a sub-basin recommendation from 1990. That was a long time ago, and nothing has been done. I'm always trying to inform people about protecting our watershed. And we do know that much of the money and time and effort has been put into the West Branch, but nothing has been done on the East Branch. Because the East Branch begins at the headwaters of North Lake and is technically in unincorporated Federway, the South End has not received the necessary care. I've come to realize that why I'm concerned that Federway has not always done their best, it is more of a King County issue. That being said, I would like to once again ask the city to step back and really think about what we are in risk of losing. I am excited to come to the next council meeting on the 21st to see the resolution passed by council for the storm water management funds. While this is an excellent start and must be part of the solution, I would like to ask even more of the city and citizens. One of the goals in these plans are to involve the community, landowners, and developers. A stream steward program is something we can do right here and today. Educating the public and creating tax incentives through various programs are just a few of the things we can do right here and now to preserve, enhance our environment and habitat. I'm heartbroken by the amount of garbage in our Hylabos Creek. It's truly a problem I think we can all work on together. It'll take some organization and effort, but if we all pull together with the city's help, we can protect our watershed. And the plan is already waiting for us. It's already there in black and white. We just gotta step forward and do this. The council has a tremendous golden opportunity to protect our Weyerhaeuser campus and the EB right now, before one tree comes down, before any wetlands get filled. I ask the council to instigate a stewardship program, ASAP. And I would like to say there are many tactics used by big corporations to discourage their opponents. When the nice guy routine doesn't work and the public rejects it, the next step is called shaming. Put us down for not making us being accepting of large development. Make us feel bad because money won't be going to our schools. Please know, we all recognize these tactics, that they're coming from secular individuals, and it's not working on us. Thank you so much.
All right, Tracy Manolidis. This is my last pink sheet. If anybody else would like to speak, please fill out a pink sheet.
Thank Tracy. You for hearing me. I just want to thank all of these engaged community members. I mean, you just have no idea how many hours they have spent researching, record zoning, walking the campus. I mean, their heart and passion is it's over the top, and they know how important this is, because if it's gone, it's gone. And I really look forward to hearing from the other community members that that know what a positive contribution IRG is going to make to Federway, because I would love to hear those details. I mean, I get a lot of details from these people that spend all these hours working on it, but let us know how IRG is just going to be the people there to bring it all together. So just thank you, community, for all you do, and thank you, council, doing your best. I know it.
Thank you. All right, thank you. All right, that's the last public comment, last pink sheet I have. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak? You know, we love to hear from the public, and it takes a lot of courage to get there. I remember the very first time I got up and spoke at the podium, I thought I did such a great job, knocked it out of the park, and I sat down, and H. David Kaplan looked at me and said, "You forgot to say your name." And so it is nerve-wracking. It takes a lot of courage. We love to hear from everyone, and we appreciate it. It helps us, because we work for you. So let's go ahead and move on to the consent agenda. item six, I'll go ahead and read the items and then we'll ask if a council member wants to discuss for separate consideration. Item A, the minutes for the January 17th, 2017 special and regular meeting. Item B, the monthly financial report, November 2016. Item C, oh, you know what? Gary, we're going to get to that issue as soon as the consent agenda is done. I forgot about that, okay? As soon as we get done with the consent agenda, I'll take care of that issue. Vouchers, November 2016. Item D, award of the Performing Arts and Events Center Orchestra Shell. Item E, Dumas Bay retainage release. Item F, Historical Society MOU, Memorandum of Understanding. Item G, Tax Recovery Services Contract Amendment. Council, is there a particular item you would want pulled for separate consideration? Okay, hearing none, Deputy Mayor Burbridge.
I move approval of items A through G on the consent agenda.
Second.
It's been a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The matters passed unanimously. Marwan, I was delinquent or forgot to bring up that issue. Just briefly, this evening, you actually gave Mr. Grant that sheet of paper.
Yes, I did.
Who wrote that?
That's wrote by Rec Perez, our traffic engineer.
Okay, just very briefly for the council's edification, we've got at least one council member that lives in that general area. We're talking 21st Avenue, Southwest, and 349th. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, what's the gist of what's going on here?
Mr. Grant's issue is that there is a Northwest Church, a driveway, that front 21st Avenue on the opposite side of 349th. The driveway is a right in, right out, and properly signed as such. Is signed on the pavement where the arrow showing that it's right out, no left turn, and also signage prohibiting the movement of left turn. Mr. Grant's issue is that he would like to see that particular driveway secured a little bit further by having a C-curb. The challenge we have, if you put a C-curb, we have four lane on 21st Avenue, two in each direction. And if you put a C-curb in the middle of the roadway, that will prevent people from being able to make a left turn into 349th.
Going southbound or northbound, either way.
You know, so that would be the challenge for us putting a C-curb in the middle of the road. The other option that Mr. Grant would like to see is for us to put a C-curb between the two northbound lanes to prevent people from being able to go and make the left turn. The challenge with that particular approach is it may create more of a safety concern, because what's going to happen is that's going to be a safety issue for bike rider. It's going to be a safety issue for at night when people trying to get out of the church and they may not be able to see the C-curb. It's going to be an issue for us when we plow the roadway. Now you have a curb that normally you don't see a curb dividing two lane going in the same direction. So these are some of the concern. Now, Rick have in his memo to Mr. Grant identified that there is three accidents reported between 2011 and 2015. And the way we rate safety issue at intersection is the number of accidents based on the number of vehicle passing through that intersection. That particular location ranked 195 based on priority within other city intersection having similar issue. So from a priority perspective, it does not rank that high. Mr. Grant got with REC, and they estimated the cost, and Mr. Grant mentioned the cost that the city doesn't have that fund. We are talking about $15,000 to $20,000. But the issue would be that money could be spent on higher ranked intersection with regard to a safety issue. In this particular case, yes, we had three accidents in the last 7 years, but the number of vehicle that run through that intersection, it make it, as I mentioned earlier, it rank about almost 198 from a safety perspective. So the priority is not there, and the recommendation from REC is not to do anything other than make sure that's properly enforced because it have the proper signage, and the intent of it is right in, right out.
Okay, you and I, before this meeting, were on Google Maps looking at this. Let's schedule time later this week with you and I and Rick and talk about this further, and then we'll get back with Mr. Grant.
All right.
Mr. Grant, we've already had your public comment. Thank you. Councilmember Honda?
About 20 years, I was in a three-car accident there. It wasn't my fault, but it was pretty darn scary. What is the issue with
Well, it's really about you've got Northwest, you've got that church there, right, at 349 to 21st, and on Sundays you've got people that are, they're not supposed to turn left and go southbound on 21st, and that's an illegal action, but it's occurring. And so then you've also got people that are, when they're going north, they want to turn left, and it's just that the confluence of a lot of traffic there. So we've also got to make sure, like, if you put a C-curb there, we've had certain situations in which we've fixed locations like this, but when we're snow plowing, there's an issue that we've got to worry about in regard to snow plowing and how that would affect that and the safety of the folks doing that. But we also have to worry about if you put dividers on two lanes right there at night, does that then become a danger in and of itself where you're going to have people changing lanes or doing something where you actually cause, by trying to fix something, you actually create a more dangerous location. So we're going to talk about that. Councilmember Ruselski?
Yes, thanks, Mayor Farrell. So Marwan, thanks for the little update there. So you said that there's proper markings to prevent left turns southbound into the church.
That's correct, Councilman Ruselski. We have proper marking on the pavement, and we have signage indicating no left turn.
Okay, and no left turn out of the parking lot onto 21st.
Just and right in. Also from 21st into that particular driveway, there is a sign say no left mm-hmm. turn from 21st into that driveway.
Okay, so it becomes an enforcement issue then.
That's correct.
And I'm wondering, and I know this would be Chief Wang's area, I know we don't have this available right now, but if there's ever been any citations for improper turning into and out of the church, if we would have record of that, if we can even talk about that. And I know you wouldn't have that on hand right now, but and secondly, if it would be possible to create a situation where we do have enforcement on site, probably during church service times, you know, Sundays or whenever the church services exist, if we can station somebody there to do some enforcement for a few weeks or some time to give people the message that they should follow the rules there.
I would tell you that our officers do work 21st Avenue. It's a main arterial street. I don't think we could ever narrow down to exactly where the enforcement took place or the driveway location, but we do work the street from time to time based on priority in terms of accidents. I could tell you just over the years that driveway at that particular location, we haven't had too many experience in terms of accidents. I would prefer maybe being proactive and talking to the congregation, talking to the pastor and leadership, maybe communicating that way and making sure that the church goers know that from time to time we are going to conduct enforcement, but I would rather take that soft, positive approach. And we will tell patrol officers working on Sundays to work that location from time to time.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Chief.
All right. Thank you very much. Chief will follow up as well. Marwan, let's go ahead and set that up. All right. Thank you, everybody. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Grant, for coming and alerting us to this issue and for your efforts. Okay. Council business. Branding presentation. We have a preferred, we actually were going to have a staff a presentation from Rusty George tonight, but the presenter was ill, and in fact, it sounds like several members of Rusty George fell ill with a severe cold. So at this point, I think it's desired that we move this to the next meeting. Deputy Mayor Burbridge?
Yes, and I do have a motion to that effect. I move to postpone item 7A to the next regular council meeting.
Second that.
All right, there's been a motion, a second. Is there any discussion? All right, all those in favor of moving this presentation to the next council meeting.
Aye.
Oh, I'm sorry. Councilmember Hinda.
Thank you. So my discussion point would be perhaps, I don't know, I haven't checked the webpage yet, but if we could put the options out on the webpage, get the folks, the citizens, to review them since it's already been presented at the retreat, so it's public knowledge.
There's also been some options about cleaning up and sprucing up our logo with a medallion. So I'll ask Steve to do that. But in regard to the, there's been, go ahead. That's You want that put on the website?
Sure, so that we can get the public to see what we've been seeing.
Okay, sounds good.
And Mr. Mayor, if I'm not mistaken, that was one of the recommendations that came out of the retreat, and so I anticipate that will happen.
Well, it is. We were going to wait to see what happened here today once the presentation was given in regard to, you know, public outreach. But if the direction is, am I hearing that unanimously that, or is there any voice in opposition to getting that out there? Councilmember Copain?
I think the only concern I have is that we haven't completed the choices yet. So some
right.
might go prematurely and only see a couple options. I think it'd be good to wait until we have every option out.
Yeah, like just
Mr. Mayor,
tonight.
Point of order.
Yes.
We currently have a motion on the table, and when you have a motion to postpone, you can't discuss or debate the subject matter of what's at stake. You actually have to decide whether you're going to postpone the motion or postpone the agenda item or continue with the debate at a later point in the meeting.
Okay.
So are you saying that we vote to postpone it, yes or no, and then debate it when we come back in 2 weeks?
That's correct, because when you have a motion to postpone, only the subject matter itself is not debatable.
Right.
And so I want to avoid walking through the process of you debating an issue that isn't before the council right now.
Okay.
For a point of information, I think there are some pros and cons about getting all this out there before it's fully baked, before we have...
Right, and if council would like to discuss this more, the maker of the motion can always withdraw it, and you can debate some of these issues, or you can choose to vote on the motion as presented.
I think we better clear this up because I think what last thing I want to do is have a presumption or an impression by the council that I'm going to do something, mm-hmm. not do it, and then have people on the council concerned or the public concerned that I didn't do what was asked. So
I withdraw the motion.
Is the second withdrawn?
I'll second it. I'll remove the second, yeah.
So the motion and the second is withdrawn. So the real issue is, even just tonight, before we were getting started, there was some feedback about what color on one of the options, whether maybe altering the color a little bit. Do you think that, let me just throw this out there. It's you know, you guys are the deliberative body. I'm just running the meeting. Do you think that there could be some merit to making sure that we've got all the options ready to go and fully baked before we get them out to the public?
Yes.
Or do you want to get the options out now and get the feedback in preparation for the meeting on the 21st? So I'll just throw that out as sort of, Councilmember Duclos.
Well, I would like to get the options fully done and then look at them.
Okay, so that's maybe waiting. Okay, Deputy Mayor Burbidge, did you have something?
I think that makes sense. I think that to release them bit by bit does not make sense. That to have opportunity to look at all the options together rather than maybe two and then adding a third one later.
Is this with the understanding that I think where Councilmember Honda is, not to speak for you, Councilmember Honda, but I think the idea, though, is that once we do get two good solid options, that we, I think it's desired by everybody, that we account the community input before we make a final decision. Mm-hmm. Is that, or are we in agreement mm-hmm. there? Mm-hmm.
Two or more.
Which will also include the current logo with maybe a medallion and some modifications.
Well,
Councilmember Honda? No.
Even in 2 weeks when we talk about this, we're not going to have anything finalized if we bring it to the council and we do something with the current. Just the information's been, it's public. It was at the retreat. It could be in the newspaper for all we know this week. I'm just saying let's get ahead of it. That's all.
Okay, and that's a valid point.
I mean, it's very likely to be in the newspaper.
Point of clarification, when you say get ahead of it, what do you mean?
Well, just get it out on our webpage. These are two options with more options, with possibly more suggestions coming.
I don't have a problem with that because I'd really like to go out to the community and see what their opinion is on the options.
Yeah,
Okay. All right. So this is why we withdrew the motion, so we could actually have a good discussion. Councilmember Moore?
Yeah, I appreciate this authentic conversation that we're having back and forth. And Councilmember Honda, I totally respect what you're saying. My concern is, will we confuse the voters when we have two more additional logos that come up? So I think it makes sense to let's quickly, because I think we've talked about this for a very long time, let's come up with the four final options. Let's put it on the website. Let's put it up for a vote. And maybe we can even put up a notice saying, hey, you know, here, this is coming in a couple weeks, more to come. You know, maybe putting that notification out there, or maybe not. But again, I respect what you're saying, but I think we should just do it all at once.
I would caution saying put it out for a vote, put it out for comment.
Right. Because the council will be making the decision. The newspaper could have something else out there. So I think we watch the newspaper then and see if we need to respond to it. Because they could say that these are the two choices and not have the whole story behind it.
Mm-hmm. It's a good, you know what, this is a good discussion, just to make sure that we're all on the same page. Councilmember Selson?
Yes, thanks, Mayor Farrell. Yeah, I agree as well that I think we should, we need to get the input. There's no doubt about it. This is a city of 95,000 people, and there are going to be a lot of opinions, and we need to do what the citizens want. But we need to have it all organized. We need to have it, have the choices, however many there are. We need to have them, I think, at least figured out before we put them out there. We can't determine what the mayor is going to do. They may put them out there in the edition coming out on Friday. But all we can do is try to organize as best we can this effort and put it all together and then put it out in front of the citizens before we vote.
Yeah. Okay, Councilmember Kopeck.
I also think that the cost for implementation of any logo change needs to be incorporated in that poll when that poll does take place.
I talked to Steve McNay about that today. Steve has been in the back of the room. I talked to him earlier today about that, and we'll make sure. Obviously, you know, we've got, as we talked about at the retreat, that there's the short-term just implementation of the logo itself, but then there's the bigger issue of launch and those kinds of costs. So we'll explore those as well and try to nail down those costs. Councilmember Duke?
Well, in terms of cost, too, they can be spread out over,
right,
because we don't have to do everything all at once. So
that's right.
It can be phased in.
Deputy Mayor Burbridge and then Councilmember Safa Dawson.
I agree that the implementation can be spread out, but I think that it needs to be looked at in some detail. For example, with the directional signage that is used for features in Federal Way, we have been waiting for the rebranding decisions prior to adding a sign for the 9/11 memorial, not wanting to spend funds on a new sign that might have a logo that would immediately need to be changed. So I think looking at the particular areas and categories of spending can make sense in helping us to make our final decision as to the timing that we want to use to proceed.
Okay. Councilmember Safa Dawson.
Yeah, I also agree that we should wait. However, if there's a concern with the mirror printing it, I wonder if we could send him some kind of a memo or news release saying that we are going to be working on this and we're going to ask for citizen input, and maybe that be published at the same time if they're planning to publish it.
Yeah, or maybe even proactively reach out to the mirror and engage. That's a great idea.
Right,
We've got Steve, who frequently talks to the mirror on a daily basis. Okay, I think Councilmember Kopeck.
I was going to say one more thing. The mirror actually does polls.
Yeah,
and they could be a partner for us in this process.
That's right.
Yeah.
Actually, we talked about that at the retreat.
Yeah,
that's right. And we're going to need their help on this. I think once the council makes that decision about what to do, I think we're going to need their help and partnership in that finalized process. I do know that Rusty George is a little concerned. You know, I could just give you some honest feedback. I think Rusty George is a little concerned about this stage in the process, but we're in a different role than Rusty George, and we represent the people, and obviously, it's their money, and so we need to make sure that what we do represents their best interest. So I don't think we need a motion on this. I think we've got general consensus. Steve, do you understand the direction?
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you. And so we'll do that. We'll get that out, and it's much better to be proactive as opposed to chasing the story, and I think that's what originated this concern, and to make sure that the public is fully informed and buys in. That being said, is there a motion? Deputy Mayor Burbidge.
I move to postpone item 7A to the next regular council meeting.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, the matter passes unanimously. All right, now, Microsoft Enterprise Agreement Renewal. Staff report from Thomas Fitchner, IT manager.
Good evening, Mayor Farrell, Deputy Mayor Burbidge, and council members. I am before you tonight.
Thomas, can you speak up just a bit, maybe into the microphone?
Yes.
Thank you.
To present the Microsoft Enterprise Agreement renewal. Quick summary and background of this is we've been under a Microsoft Enterprise Agreement since 2008. What that does is it covers the licensing for all of our Microsoft software, whether it be Windows on the desktop for the computers, Windows for the server side of things, Microsoft Office, our SQL Server, Exchange, et cetera. All the products that we have for Microsoft, it falls under this. What it provides is technical support. So if we have any issue with any of the products, we're able to get technical support, whether it be via phone or email. Updates to the latest versions, so as soon as they release a product, we can get it and we can install it. Staff training, up to about 30 hours of staff training on site, and then also unlimited via the web. And also a home use product or program that allows staff to work at home to buy the Office product at a reduced cost. And also this enterprise agreement, we're purchasing off of the Washington State Department of Enterprise Services contract. So they have a master contract that they negotiate every 3 years. And that allows us to purchase this Microsoft software at what they call Enterprise Level D, which is significant cost savings over if we were just to license just our licenses that we have. For us, we're just a small to medium business, but grouped under that contract, we're a huge enterprise. This is hard to see. It's not meant to be detailed here, but that basically just shows you an entire list, itemized, of every product that we have that we'll be purchasing, and then a total cost. However, the next slide kind of summarizes it in an easy to digest. Every year, it's 2017 will be $94,713.65, followed by 2018 and 19 payments shown there as well. The reason there's a 5% inflator is because of that DES contract. It renews every 3 years. We renew every 3 years. However, they're not succinct. So it's actually up for renewal this year. And so we cannot guarantee, based on the reseller that Washington State selects this year, that our next year payment will be identical, depending on the pricing that they get. So that's why we allocate a 5% inflator. For a total with tax of $322,973.55 over the total 3 years. Any questions?
Council, any questions? Councilmember Hondo.
I don't have a question. I just want to thank you for all you do. I think you must have one of the toughest jobs in the city, keeping everything running and going, and I appreciate what you do.
Well, thank you. I couldn't do it without my team as well. So.
All right. Councilmember Duclos, do you have a motion?
Yes, and I second those comments from Councilmember Honda. I move to approve the renewal of the Microsoft Enterprise Agreement for the years 2017 through 2020 and authorize the mayor to execute said agreement.
Second.
All right, there's been a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? I would third that. Thank you so much for all you do. We really appreciate, we all appreciate all the work you do and making sure it's an information age, and so
it is.
You hold a special relationship, and
this is just one of the small things that a contract that we have that we maintain for the entire city.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? All right, matter passed unanimously.
Thank you.
Great job. All right, planning commission appointments. Councilmember Selsky.
Yes, thanks, Mayor. So I move to appoint the following individuals to the Planning Commission as follows. Diana Noble Gulliford, voting position expiring September 30th, 2020. Tim O'Neill, voting position expiring September 30th, 2020. Don Meter McCausland, voting position expiring September 30th, 2020 as well. And Dale Couture, alternate expiring September 30th, 2018.
All right, and that's in the form of a motion?
Yes.
Second.
All right. There was a motion and multiple seconds. Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Congratulations to those individuals. All right. Ethics Board Commission appointments. Deputy Mayor Burbidge.
I move to appoint the following individuals to the Ethics Board with appointments expiring June 30th, 2019. Sadia Abdullah, thank you, excuse me. Catherine Hancock.
Second.
All right, there's been a motion, a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right, matter passed unanimously. All right, Parks and Recreation appointment. Councilmember Kopeck.
I'd like to make a motion to, or I move to appoint the following individuals to the Park and Recreation Commission as follows. Steve Payne to voting position expiring April 30th, 2017. And Steve, we're encouraging you to reapply. David Music, voting position expiring April 30th, 2019. And then Roger Flygar as the alternate expiring April 30th, 2019.
Second.
All right, there's been a motion and a second.
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right. All right, now matter passes unanimously. The individual appointments are appointed. All right, ordinances number 8. This is the second reading. Would the city clerk please read the ordinance title?
Council Bill 720, establishing a transportation benefit district, TBD, an ordinance of the city of Federalway, Washington, relating to the establishment of a transportation benefit district and adding chapter 3.26 to the Federalway revised code.
All right, Councilmember Shelsky.
Yes, thank you. I'm going to pass on making this motion. During the last council meeting we had a few weeks ago, I expressed my concern about establishing a TBD and really what it implies. And so my concern still exists to this day, so I'm going to pass on making that motion.
All right. Now, Council, Mr. Orthman, if no motion is made, what happens to the ordinance?
If no motion is made, the agenda item fails and there is no action taken.
All right. If a motion is made and it's not seconded, what occurs?
The same result that would fail.
All right. But if a motion is made and there's a second, then we go from there.
Then you have an up-down vote unless there's an amendment to the motion.
All right. Councilmember Selsky has declined to make the motion. Is there anybody else who would like to make the motion? All right. Hearing none, the matter fails for a motion. All right, council reports. We will start with Councilmember Dini Duclos.
Well, I'll go real quick. I just wanted to thank the staff, especially for the retreat and all the work that they did on that, and the people for showing up. And my special thanks to the heating committee because we were warm this year. And I think we did have some good discussion and some good things come out of it. And I'm especially excited about what we're going to be looking at in terms of the logo for the city. I think we have some really, really good ideas. And I'd be looking forward to sharing it with the community and actually getting some feedback, maybe having a poll in the mirror when they're put out there as to which one the people that live here would really like to see as their postcard for the city. So with that, I will end, and maybe we'll get out of here before 9:30.
And I do want to say, Councilmember Duclos, I do want to say a special thank you. You know, we had a great time. We enjoyed everybody's comments. But I have taken to heart your comment about, you know, having much more of the team building and the vision for the future. And I think it was well taken and well received. And I think I've heard from several of your colleagues that they'd like to see that. So that's what it takes is for that kind of feedback. So thank you.
Thank you.
Councilmember Moore.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor. You know, you hear it a lot, and I'll say it again because it couldn't be any farther from the truth, that this is the best city in the state of Washington. And the reason why I say that is because, like my colleagues have stated, we have an amazing staff that's dedicated, that's incredibly dedicated, to emphasize that. And they're absolutely relentless in doing the best possible job in serving all of us. And I want to take the time to read a comment that just made me feel really good. And I think we need to be reminded of the fact that all of us, really try hard to do what's right. And that sometimes the decisions we make are not only difficult, but sometimes they're unfavorable. So before I go any further, let me just read this comment. This is by Mrs. Stiles. She said that she went back to work today after the snow started on Monday, and she wanted to say that she was dreading getting out of our neighborhood, but as soon as we got out of our street and onto the main road, it was all plowed and clear, including our very steep hill. Shout out to the city and its plowers. Thank you. And I think, like I said, we need to be reminded that all of us are working hard to really build a city that's compassionate, a city that prides itself in the future, the city that works hard through the challenges, and the city that works really hard to partner up with people, organizations to solve problems. And I'm just thrilled to be one of just many people that's in this community. And I thank you, Mr. Mayor, for letting me share those comments. And with that, I will end my report. Thank you.
Great. Councilmember Cupang.
It's been 3 weeks since we had a council meeting. We had that great retreat here this weekend, and I really appreciate the conversation that we got to enjoy as colleagues, and certainly appreciate the support of the staff to both in their preparation and in making sure the retreat was a success. Couple things that happened in those 3 weeks were got a chance to tour Valley Cities. Valley Cities is a very important partner in our city. They are focused on really counseling people with drug issues, helping people to in recovery to get to reestablish themselves, and a number of other different services. But again, a great organization that's been a part of Federal Way for years. They have now moved their support building and their staff right next door where Morford Track used to be. And again, it's a beautiful space, and they are using almost all of it, and really creating great solutions for the citizens of Federal Way in need of their services. Also got a chance to hang out on the corner doing sign waving, this time not for a political candidate, but in support of our police officers and the fine work that they do day in and day out to ensure the safety of our community. Got to do it with a lot of great people. And again, it's not something that was done for any other reason than just to express appreciation for the fine work of our police department. And that is all I have.
Councilmember Honda.
Thank you. I'd like to repeat that New Hope Community Church is open tonight for shelter. So if you know anyone, they need to be moving towards that location before the doors are closed at 10 o'clock or so. I'm a member of the King County Board of Health, and at our last meeting, the Board of Health passed a motion to accept the opiate task force recommendations, and one of those recommendations was to support CHEL sites, which are community health engagement locations or safe injection sites. We as board members believe that the two locations at the safe injection sites were recommended were both in the city of Seattle. In the task force recommendation, there was a recommendation to have one of those sites in Seattle and one in outside of Seattle in King County somewhere. So if you read anything in the newspaper or follow what's going on, there's been people who support this and people who don't support it. At this point in time, I haven't been informed exactly where the locations are going to be. So I would say to keep following that, and we'll see what happens. The Board of Health does meet on the third Thursday of the month at 1:30 up in King County. So if you have anything you'd like to say, you could either send an email, you could come up and testify, or you could let me know and I can pass your thoughts along. AYR is having their annual fundraising breakfast this Friday. It's at 6:30 down in Auburn, very early. It is their major fundraising, and AYR is Auburn Youth Resources. So it does start at 6:30, and hopefully, if you want to, you could go. I will be attending the DVI Regional Task Force meeting next week down in Auburn. I'm the caucus chair, and we meet four times a year as a task force. The city of Federal Way is lucky in that we have our own task force here in Federal Way, and we meet every month on the fourth Friday. And it's a domestic violence is a really hard thing to, you know, there it's really sad, and it's really hard to listen to some of the information that we get. And the people that work daily with domestic violence, I really, really applaud them and respect them and can't imagine how they can do what they do. So we're lucky that in Federal Way we have so many caring people who want to help those who are victims of domestic violence. I'd also like to thank all of those folks who applied for commissions. We met here, we started at 4:30 this afternoon, and we interviewed a lot of people. And if you weren't selected for a commission this time, I would suggest that you continue to volunteer and continue to be supportive. We volunteers make the city run. We need volunteers are vital to what kind of work we can get done in the city. And so I would just encourage you to look at maybe reapplying again. We always have openings, and we do have specific spots on each commission. So we can't put everyone who volunteers who comes to interview on a commission if we don't have the spots available. And thank you to Public Works for all the work they've done to keep our streets safe. At 4 o'clock, as I was leaving to come here today, my street was being sanded. So I hope when I go home I don't slide down the hill because I know it was sanded. Thank you.
Very good. Councilmember Salisbury.
Yes, I agree with Councilmember Copang that there have been a lot of events going on in the past few weeks since we had our last meeting. And one of the events that occurred was the Day Center grand opening a couple weeks ago. And I'd like to thank Father McKee from St. Vincent de Paul Parish for doing the blessing of the facility, but also the blessing of the cause of the Day Center open for those citizens of Federal Way and really citizens from outside Federal Way who need those services during the day. I'd like to thank Catholic Community Services, the staff, and the many, many volunteers who were there that day and who staffed this facility day after day so that our the attendees can come in and reach the services that are there as they need these on a day-to-day basis. So, and it's rewarding to know that people are actually using it. I believe it started a month or two ago with 10 or 20, and I believe it's up higher than that number now. So it's just good that, and the city participated. We are participating in, in providing the services as well. So I'm quite proud of that. A few weeks ago, too, I was able to tour the men and women's overnight shelter with the deputy mayor and council member Moore, and it gave me a greater appreciation for the massive amount of effort it takes to coordinate and operate this facility. And as we walked into the women's shelter, council member Moore and council member Honda and another volunteer were serving meals to the women at the shelter that night. So it was great to see that, and thank you for your efforts there. And lastly, I want to thank the mayor for an outstanding State of the City address last week. It was uplifting. It was forward-looking. I talked to a lot of folks after that and thought it was a tremendous effort and really, really got the message across on what the city is doing to move forward in this day and age. So that's it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Councilmember Sepa Dawson.
Thank you.
So the day that they had the tour for the shelter, I couldn't join because I went to the one-night count, which is now called Count Me In for the homeless. And so went to multi-service center at 1 a.m., I think, and we were there till 6, and I just went to work from there. And so I just want to say thank you to everyone who's really involved in the homelessness issues, because we're just scratching the surface on this, but I think we're doing something to support the homeless as well as the continuum of housing when we look at, you know, what our city is doing. And I just want to share my appreciation for what's happening and that we're being engaged and that we are more involved in supporting the homeless population. So thank you, Susan, and thank you, Sherry. And hopefully as we move forward, there's more resources and more support for people who are really homeless, chronic homeless, and also those who really just are homeless because of all the various reasons. So that the one-night count, the way they're doing the counting has changed now, so it's going to be a while before we get the response or the report. And this is going to be the baseline moving forward, and what they did this time was had everyone go out and just, you know, look at the zip code, here's our map, here's our city, go and look for people who are out on the street. So, and then they also had clusters that they called hot areas. And so people were actually charged to just go out and to the communities and look for people who are either in their cars or out in the on the street. And so it'll be a while before we get the response, unlike the way it used to be done. So that being said, though, there was, I just want to shout out to the people who were there that night, city staff. So from Parks and Recreation, we had Tony Collins, Tom Boyd, Anthony Hutchinson, Joe Broughton, and Carol Lum. And then from Surface Water, we had Holly Shilley and Mindy English, and Sarah Bridgeford from Human Services, and then we also had Randy Smith from the Diversity Commission. And I just want to say shout out to all these people who, over and above their city commitment, they took the time to come and also volunteer in our community to participate in this event. And just to echo what you said about boards and commission, thank you for those who applied, and want to encourage others to get involved in this way. The people we interviewed today were amazing, great talent and great experience. So like you said, unfortunately, we can't get everyone on the board, but encouraging them to get involved in ways that they can. So thank you very much. That ends my report.
All right. Deputy Mayor Burbidge.
Okay, thank you very much. The Lodging Tax Advisory Committee had a meeting scheduled and a retreat for tomorrow morning. That has been canceled. Problems with people's schedules necessitate that. And just those who would be attending, stay tuned and you'll be notified of the new date and time for that. Last week I was able to help welcome the new officers for the Evergreen Seniors Korean Club at the community center. It was a wonderful program. And after the formalities were over, it was delightful to be able to observe a wonderful demonstration of the line dancing that a number of the people in that group enjoy. Also, I wanted to mention again the retreat briefly and say thanks to the council for such great participation, to the staff for their outstanding preparation and sharing with the council, and of course the community members who took the time to come and share their ideas and concerns. I also want to mention our library system. The King County Library System offers so many informative programs along with their other opportunities with information sharing in so many modes. Right now they have a program ongoing called Paths to Recovery. They had an initial presentation regarding this some months ago, but they're now continuing with presentations throughout the county, including at our Federal Way Library on First Avenue South. So you might want to look at their schedules online and stop by the library if you're interested. I also received a very wonderful email today, and I want to read it. It's from the Morris family, and I'll just read the email. It's brief. Hello, awesome people. Thank you for your hard work and many late hours clearing the streets of Federal Way. You did a great job. Thanks, Dave Morris. And I just found that very touching that they took the time to send that email. So that concludes my report.
All right. All right, with that, we are adjourned. Thank you very much, everybody. Great meeting.